Thank you, Joanna, and everyone for having me here. Before discussing about Ahmadiyya translation of the Quran and also dakwah and Quran translation, I think I will briefly discussing about the Ahmadiyya, because this one is the most controversial and misunderstood Muslim organization in the world. So I'm not an Ahmadi. I'm Muhammadi, Muhammadiyya member of the Muhammadiyya organization, but some people call me Half Ahmadi or Almost Ahmadi or special member of Ahmadiyya. I think that's also correct because it seems I'm more Ahmadi than Kamran. I met with the Caliph and also live in Mirza Ghulam Ahmad house for 10 days, so that justify my Ahmadiness. Okay, so this one is about the Ahmad. I think can be used as a background of the next presenters. This one is a religious movement established in 1889 and considered by, I think, most of the Muslim organization as a heretical group, and established by Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. In this community, it's mostly called as Al-Masih, Al-Ma'ud, not Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. And in 1914, split into two groups. The first one is Ahmadiyya Muslim Jemaat, or perhaps we can call it Jemaat, just Jemaat. And then the second one is Ahmadiyya Anjuman Isyaat Islam, Lahuri, or we call it Lahuri Ahmadiyya. It has around 10 million followers in more than around 200 countries, and the majority in like Indian subcontinent, Indonesia, and West Africa. Kamran asked me yesterday how many people Ahmadi in Indonesia. I said around 1 million people, between 500 and 1 million people. So this one is like the largest, perhaps the second largest or the third largest Ahmadiyya community in the world. And it came in 1920s. And the first one who brought there is Khawaja Kamaluddin. This one, the way to write Kamaluddin is Kamaluddin. It's a bit strange for now. And but the real missionary work began in 1924, and then the Jemaat in 1925. This is some distinctive beliefs of the Ahmadiyya. The first one is the belief that Al-Masih Ma'ud is a prophet, a Messiah, a Mahdi, and then the 10 avatar of Krishna. And also Jesus did not die on the cross or elevated physically to the heaven, but died with normal death in Kashmir, India, in normal age 120, after moving from Jerusalem to India, to Kashmir. Correct me, Kamran, if I'm wrong. And then, so they have a tremendous emphasis on jihad, to the point that other Muslims calling them like abrogating or neglecting to wage warfare jihad because of their focus on jihad fil kalam, not jihad this time. So the community, this is the third distinctive teaching of the Ahmadiyya, is the concept of zakah, the concept of chanda, 1/16, 1/10, 1/3 of their income will go to the organization. And then the fifth one is the leader of this community is the Caliph, the promised Messiah, the Caliph of the promised Messiah, and currently in London, previously in Qadian, and then moved to Rabwah, Pakistan, and then moved to UK. And this one is the flag of the Ahmadiyya, and that was that is the picture of me together with the Caliph. This one is the founder of the Ahmadiyya, Al-Masih Al-Ma'ud. And this one, Minarat Al-Masih, is the place where Jesus in Ahmadiyya belief already descended to this world in the form of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. It's not waiting for the Jesus to come, but it's already come to the earth. And then this is related to the Quran. So this community have been, I think, accused by other Muslim of having a different holy book. It is called Tadhkirah instead of the Quran. And this one has become like a common accusation. It's not only in Indonesia, I think in Pakistan, also in other countries. While they believe that this one is not their holy book, their holy book is the same as other Muslim. That is the Quran. This one is the Tadhkirah. It's like divine revelations, dreams, and visions received by Mirza Ghulam Ahmad during his lifetime. And because of the belief of the people that they have a different Quran, different place of pilgrimage, attack to this community is very often. And one of them is also burning the Quran, that they believe that this one is different Quran from the rest of the Muslim, and also burning the mosque of the Ahmadiyya in several places in the country. And even killing to the Ahmadi people in 2011. So Ahmadiyya translations are available in several languages in Indonesia, Dutch, Malay, Javanese, Sundanese, Balinese, and also Batakis. And in the early 1920s, in the early 20th century, it was regarded as an important source of knowledge about Islam, and also used by President Soekarno, the first president of the country, and also by Agus Salim, Cokro Aminoto, and some prominent figures in the country. So the question is, why did Ahmadiyya translation have such a prominent place in the first half of the 20th century in Indonesia? And what was the appeal of this translation to Indonesian intelligentsia? And also, what is the contribution of this translation to the study of the Quran in the country? So we can say that both the Jumaat and also Lahuri Ahmadiyya can be considered among the pioneers in translating the Quran into various languages, particularly with regard to the Western form of translation using columns and also footnotes. And this one, they use it as a way to implement the doctrine of Jihad bil Qalam, Jihad of the Pen. And as I will show you later, that Rashid Ridho and also Sayyid Usman from Jakarta opposing the translation with his book Hukmur Rahman bin Nahyi anit Tarjamat bil Quran. So for the Lahuri Ahmadiyya translation, the main translation is Muhammad Ali's The Holy Quran, containing the Arabic text with English translation and commentary. It was published in 1917, it was first published by Islamic Review Office in Woking, London, 1917. And then I was discussing with Kamran again, the idea to translate the Quran came up in 1907. But you said that earlier than that one. But the process of the translation started in 1909 and took 7 years to finish it. And Ahmadiyya is also among the pioneer of female translator of the Quran, like Ahmadur Rahman, Omar, and her husband. This one, the son of the first caliph of the Ahmadiyya, Nuruddin. Among the characteristics, if we try to dig deeper to the Holy Quran written by Muhammad Ali, so it tries to demonstrate the compatibility between the Holy Book and modern sciences. So he tries to say that the word of God, revelation, and the work of God, creation, do not contradict each other. And also one of the characteristics is underlines the completeness of the Quran, is trying to refuse the perspective from the certain Shiite community and also certain people that the Quran is not complete or reduced or corrupted and something like that. And then to strengthen that kind of belief, this community opposed the idea of Nasikh and Mansukh abrogating and abrogated verses of the Quran. So there is no nasih and mansukh in the Quran. And then it contains a lengthy preface, and then it introduced new ideas about Jesus and his crucifixion. So I quote a few examples of the translation from Muhammad Ali. The first one is Wadis Taspa Musa Liqaumihi Fakul Nab Drib Bi Ashokal Hajar. And then the word Idrib Bi Ashokal Hajar, he translated into march on the rock with their staff. So it's different from the Yusuf Ali, who translated it, strike the rock with their staff. So it's he against a miracle. So translating that it's not like striking the rock and then dividing the sea, but this is like walking with your staff on the rock, something like that. And then also, if we see traditionally Muslim exegetes render the story of the dialogue between Prophet Solomon and the ants literally, implying that the Prophet Solomon can understand the language of ants. In contrast to this traditional understanding and tradition and translation, Ali translate Quran 27:18 as until when they came to the valley of the Namal, a Namlite said, "O Namal, enter your house. Solomon and his house crush you, while they know not." For Ali, Namal is a proper noun, and Namlah is the name of a tribe, which is why he uses the capital N. Therefore, this verse doesn't talk about the ability of Solomon to understand the language of animal, but it's like a name of tribe, something like that. And then likewise, in the story of Sheba, the jinn mentioned in Quran 27:39 is not understood to be a magical spirit, but one of the Amalekites, a mountain tribe, who was who were men of large stature. So it's not something that unseen in this world. And then this one is translation from Jemaat, another group. It's like waqaulihim inna qatalnal masiha Isa bin Maryam rasulullah wa ma qataluhu wa ma salabuhu walakin subbiha lahum wa innal ladzina ikhtalafu fihi la fi syakkin minhu ma lahum bihi min ilm and so on. This one is translated by Zafrullah Khan, one of the famous translator of the Ahmadiyya. We did kill the Messiah, Jesus son of Mary, the messenger of Allah, whereas they slew him not, nor did they compass his death on the cross, but he was made to appear to them like one crucified to death. And those who have differed in the matter of his having been taken down alive from the cross are certainly in the state of doubt concerning it. They have no definite knowledge about it, but only follow conjecture and go on something like that. And then to strengthen the argument that Jesus did not die on the cross, you see that this one is the tomb of Jesus in Srinagar, Kashmir, after moving from Jerusalem to Kashmir, India, at the age of 120. So this one is like there are two tombs, and one of them is believed to be the tomb of Jesus. And then this one is another different translation of the Quran. Subhanalladzi asra bi 'abdihi laylan minal masjidil haram ilal masjidil aqsa. Traditionally, it is understood as the mosque in Jerusalem. But for the Ahmadiyya, this could be interpreted as the mosque al-Aqsa in Qadia. It may signify the Prophet Solomon Temple at Jerusalem, the Holy Prophet's Mosque in Medina, or the Promised Messiah Mosque at Qadian. So we can see, and as I mentioned in the footnote, that we can find this one in their translation of the Quran. This one is also referring to that one from the Messiah, from Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, regarding that Al-Aqsa is in Qadian. And then this is the recitation from Muhammad Rashid Ridho on Muhammad Ali's Quran. This one is like conversation, like what you call it, like dialogue between Muhammad Basuni Amran from Sambas, Borneo. They call them at that time Jawa instead of like Borneo, because part of the Malay world and something like that. So I would like to underline several several statement from Basuni in Imran and also Muhammad Rashid Rizal in this context. The question from Basuni Imran to Muhammad Rashid Rizal is, hal yajuzul amal bi tafsir Maulawi Muhammad Ali Al-Hindi alladhi fastara bihi al-Qur'an bil lughatil injiliyah injiliziyah am la? So what about the tarjama bil lughatil malaya malawiya Al-Hajj Usman Chokro Aminoto, and then continue something like that. So this one is like regarding the translation of the English Muhammad Ali's translation of the Quran into Malay language. And then the Basuni continued that na'am qad alimtu anna mufti Misra wa Beirut lam yu'adzina bi idkhali hadhihi tafsir al-injilizi fihima. So Egypt and also Beirut refused to accept that tafsir, that tarjama, to this country. How about Indonesia? And then the reply from Muhammad Rashid Ridho, wala yumkinu ayyuftiya biha bihada illa illa man qara'a hadha tafsir aw at-tarjama at-tafsiriyah kullaha. So it's impossible to give a fatwa without reading the whole translation of that book. But then he continued that wal masyhur anna sahibuhu Muhammad Ali hadha min al-Qadiani. He made a mistake here because considering Muhammad Ali from Qadiani, well, he is from Lahuri Ahmadiyah. Wa innahu harrafa ba'dal ayatil muta'alliqah bil masih li ajli istidlal biha ala kauni Mirza Ghulam Ahmad al-Qadiani wal masih. So he believed that Muhammad Ali is Qadiani, and he make like corrupted the Quran, ba'dul ayat, part of the verses of the Quran that related to Al-Masih, for the sake of to strengthen the belief that Ghulam Ahmad is the Messiah, Al-Masih. Hada huwa min sababi man'i Sheikh Azhar wa Mufti Beirut li idkhalil Mushaf Syarif al-matbu'ah ma'ahu hadhihi tarjamah al-injiliyah. So that's the reason why Mufti from Egypt and also Syria forbid that translation. And annahum yaz'umuna anna surat al-Fatihah tadullu ala istimraril wahyi al-ilahi ila akhir zaman. So Muhammad Ali think that so this one is also mistake, that surah al-Fatihah is a proof that wahyu, that the revelation will continue to the end of the time. Wa qad radadna ala dajjalihim fi hayati. So we refuse that one, and showing that there is a dajjal or something like that. And bayanna dalalahum ba'da mautihi miraran fi majallatil manar muta'addita. So he repeated several times on this issue at Al-Manar. So that's, so this one is a conversation between someone from Indonesia, from Borneo, with Muhammad Rashid Rido. And then this one, the two famous English translation from Ahmadiyah, Sher Ali's The Holy Quran and Zabrullah Khan that I already mentioned. And this is the date of the publication of that, of those two translation of the Quran. And actually there are several similarities between Muhammad Ali and Jumu'ah translation on the death of Jesus, and also on other issues. But one of the obvious differences between the two branches of the Ahmadiyya is their view on the prophethood of Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. This one is the one that misunderstood also by Muhammad Rashid Rido at the time. And with the regard of the meaning Khatam al-Nabiyyin, the seal of the prophet, the difference is also very clear from these two organizations, which the first one is like the last prophet, and then the seal of the prophet, while the rest is the best prophet, not necessarily the last one. So this one is the verses that referred by in our discussion. Wa ma kana Muhammadun aba ahadin min rijalikum walakin rasulullah wa khataman nabiyyin. So this one is the translation from Syekh Ali and also Yusuf Ali, which is different from like from Ahmadiyah that strengthen the continuity of the prophethood of the Muhammad, the prophet, the continuity of the prophethood after the prophet Muhammad. And then the next one, so this one is among the reason of translating the Quran into several languages, a medium for proselytizing religion, to show the beauty of Islam, compatibility with modern sciences, and then to give a comprehensive guidance for religious life and to clear the ground for Ahmadiyya beliefs and teaching. And this one, I quote two statements from the Ahmadiyya, Lahore Ahmadiyya. I am going to conquer Europe by means of this. So this one, is, we are talking about Da'wah and Quran translation. This one from Khawaja Kamaluddin, when he left India as a missionary to London in 1913. And then also statement from Muhammad Ali, the real objective of our movement is the propagation of Islam. And in that world, the propagation of the Holy Quran holds the foremost place. And then this one is like the translation for the Jama'at. It has been translated into, I think, more than 75 languages, right? And also the Lahore also translating into several languages. I was there and then attending like the process of translating the Quran into several into new languages in Qadian, in the headquarters of the Ahmadiyya. And this one is the place where they studied the Quran and also the doctrine of the Ahmadiyya, Jamiah Ahmadiyya Qadian. And this one is from Rozi Hayat, Injil Amal, when Khawaja Kamaluddin like lived in Jakarta, in Yogyakarta in 1920, when he finished his, one of his important book of Da'wah and something like that. And so this one, the holy book was often employed as a weapon to convince people of the truth or the falsity of certain religion. The Quran, for instance, was used to demonstrate the superiority of Islam over other religion and the deviation of Christianity from its original teaching. That's among the use of the translation of the Quran done by like Ahmadiyya. The Christian mission utilized the gospel, I think, in similar way. So, and then how many more minutes? Five? Yeah, I will make it quick. So by showing that the Quran is a collection of revelation received by the Prophet Muhammad during his lifetime, it proves that this religion is a revealed religion, not a creation of human beings. And as stated by Muhammad Ali, the Quran is the most important miracle in Islam, not other things. And then, so this one, other function of the translation of the Quran. And then this one, the two different ways of seeing Ahmadiyya translation. The first one is related to science, and then the second one is toward Christianity. In the context of modern science, the Ahmadiyya used a defensive apologetic approach, whereas in the regard to Christianity, they employed an offensive political approach. The way the Ahmadiyya views Jesus, for instance, contradicts common Christian beliefs. This might be because of the Ahmadiyya intent to attack very core of Christianity, or their own term is to break the cross. The Ahmadiyya combined approaches to Christianity and modern science were exactly what motivated the Muslim intelligentsia in Indonesia at the beginning of the 20th century to join the Ahmadiyya or to learn about Islam from Ahmadiyya books and missionaries. This one is more detail about the translation of the Quran by the Ahmadiyya community in Indonesia. And this one is the first president who also used Ahmadiyya translation as a reference of his speech and also his understanding of Islam. And there are a number of translations of the Ahmadiyya Quran, the translation of the Quran from Ahmadiyya into several languages in Indonesia, like Sundanese, Batakis, Balinese, and also Japanese and several local languages in several areas. And even I think this translation become inspiration for several people like Chokro Aminoto, Agus Salim. This is the grandfather of one of the grand old men, something like that we call it, and also young Islamitan born. And I think I will make it quick. This one is opposition of several groups to this translation. And also this one is the most successful translation of from the Ahmadiyya community. That is the Dutch translation, sold out and printed several times in many places, Suriname, Java, South Africa, and Netherlands. And used by some intelligentsia at that time, like Sukarno and Ruslan Abdul Ghani. So the reason of the success of that translation in terms of the medium of communication, this translation used Dutch, the language of educated people in Indonesia at that time, in terms of content, offered a new understanding of Islam, which was appropriate for the needs of the Indonesian Muslim intelligentsia also at that time, namely like compatibility between religion and science. And then this one is the first available translation of the Quran in the market and accessible in terms of language. And this one is a translation into official Indonesian translation and quoting several statements from the Ahmadiyya without references. And previously with reference, but then rejected by many people, then omitted the references. That's a bit weird, I mean. And then this one is translation into several local languages in the country, and it's effective way of da'wah, because they use the term wangsit, avatar, and something like that, and then attract people to accept the Ahmadiyya belief to accept Ahmadiyya belief. And then I think this one is the conclusion that the Quran, this is I must underline this one, the Quran used by the Ahmadiyya is the same as other Muslim read and use. It's a bit theological, but it's important. And then there are some distinctive interpretations related to the issue of Messiah, prophethood, and miracles. There are two most distinctive characteristics of Ahmadiyya translation. The first, their polemical position on Christianity, reflected in the verses of about Jesus. And then the second one, their defensive stand on verses related to sciences. So this one is, if I can summarize that, because of this translation, some people did not convert into Christianity or become part of the materialist communist community and something like that. So rescuing the belief of some intelligentsia at that time. And this one is, I think, some of my works on the Ahmadiyya, if you want to read it, already published and in English. Thank